Thanks for the introduction. So first of all, I would like to point out that I'm holding this talk in place of Patrick Staehli. So he's a former PhD student and a current postdoc. So all the work I'm presenting today is actually his work. And we also, so here are two papers. You will see them in the end again if you're interested. And these are our acknowledgements for the Swiss National Science Foundation, the EU Horizon 2020 program, etc. So first of all, I would like to give a short motivation for speed of sound imaging using echo ultrasound. And all of you know ultrasound imaging, classical ultrasound imaging. And you may know that this is mostly a combination of like a grayscale image, which shows the anatomy of the tissue based on the echo intensity, but also Doppler flow imaging, which allows you to monitor blood flow. And the big advantage of ultrasound imaging in comparison to other imaging modalities is that it is mobile, it's real time, freehand and cheap, and it does not use ionizing radiation. So it has a lot of advantages, but the big disadvantage is that it has quite a low specificity for many disease types, because just having a grayscale image, you can imagine it can be difficult to differentiate between different disease types. And because of that, people have been looking for new modalities. And one of these modalities is elastography, as we've already seen for OCT. So it's a similar concept. And this allows to show us a tissue property, which is the elasticity. And for example, to detect breast cancer. So instead of palpating the breast with the fingers, you can have a 2D map of elasticity for diagnosis. And this is already quite standard in clinics. And on the other hand, we have photoacoustic imaging, where we will hear the next two presentations about from Li Hong Wang and Robert Muster. And this technique gives us a map of optical absorption, and this is mainly in the blood, so we can see blood vessels. Now, both these techniques are like in a direction towards multimodal ultrasound imaging. So the idea is to combine different parameters of the tissue and have a better diagnostic accuracy. Now, the next level in that direction could be speed of sound imaging. And why is that interesting? So on one hand, we know that the speed of sound differs a lot between different tissue types, but also we can use speed of sound for diagnosing disease types that have an influence on the microarchitecture of the tissue. So for example, we could use it to diagnosing fatty liver disease, because you can imagine that the speed of sound of fat is quite very low, and the more fat one has in the liver, the lower the speed of sound of the liver becomes. And this is from a publication from the Institut de Langevin, and some of you might know it. And they basically determined the speed of sound inside the liver using what's called echo ultrasound, but determining average liver speed of sound based on an autofocusing criterion. So they generated like ultrasound images and optimized the spatial resolution. In that way, got the speed of sound, the average speed of sound of the liver. And they could show that there is a direct connection between the fat fraction in the liver and the speed of sound they measured. So this is in using echo ultrasound. On the other hand, we have ultrasound tomography, which is mostly promoted for cancer diagnosis. And this is similar to computed tomography, X-ray computed tomography. And it is based on through transmission of ultrasound. So we insonify on one side of the breast and detect on the other side, and use a signal then rotating around the breast and use a signal to reconstruct the speed of sound, for example. And there are two very good systems, one from Delphinus and one from QT ultrasound. And you can see the marvelous, exceptional contrast for breast cancer. So the disadvantage of these two techniques is that on one hand, you have this average speed of sound estimation, which has basically no spatial resolution. But on the other hand, but it's a freehand, and you can be combined with conventional ultrasound systems. On the other hand, you have the true transmission ultrasound computed tomography. We will also see hear about it from Robert Nuster's talk. And the problem of these systems is that they are very big. So the ones we use for breast imaging, they are very big, bulky, standalone systems, expensive. So they cannot be used like at the general practitioner level. So our goal was to develop a new technique which allows to make an image, a 2D image of the speed of sound using handheld echo ultrasound. And we called it Qt, computed ultrasound tomography in echo mode. And now for the ones of you who might not be that familiar with echo ultrasound imaging, but also to put the conventions and coordinate systems, for example. So what you have in ultrasound imaging is typically such a linear array probe, where you have a line of piezoelectric elements. And from the side, so these are the coordinates. You have like X coordinate, which is parallel to the array. You have the Z coordinate, which is the axial direction, so it goes into the tissue. And we have the Y direction, which is perpendicular to the imaging plane. And from the side, we have like the piezoelectric element, an acoustic backing, matching layers, and an acoustic lens. And this focuses or collimates the ultrasound into the imaging plane. And now we use this system, we put it on the tissue. And what is then done in echo ultrasound imaging is you use a, typically a sub-aperture of this array. You transmit, you excite all these elements individually using voltage pulse. And by the time delay of the voltage pulse, one can influence on one hand like the focal length of a focus beam, but also the steering angle, so the transmit steering angle phi. And this move is just to, illustrate how these transmit delays are used to generate the focus beam. Very important here is that these delays, they are calculated based on an assumed value of the speed of sound. And we call that from now on C0. Then once the ultrasound is propagated into the tissue, you can have an acoustic reflector. We assume a point reflector and this will backscatter ultrasound. And then you can use a sub-aperture of the array. Let's put the laser pointer again. You can use a sub-aperture of the array and detect on each piezoelectric element individually a voltage signal. Now, whereas we could use a physical focusing on transmit, so we actually physically focus the beam onto this reflector, on reception, we don't do that. We just acquire these signals and then we do the focusing in software. And for that, all the signals are delayed relative to each other so that they line up, that a signal coming from the focus will line up in time across the different elements, and then the sum is performed. So this is the famous delay and sum algorithm. And if you have a reflector in the focus here, you will get a huge signal of the sum. Here again, these received delays, they are calculated based on assumed value of the speed of sound. Then, knowing the transmitted ultrasound beam and the receiving focused ultrasound beam, one can then take the signal, the sum of all the signals, which is received at the total round trip time, which consists on one hand on the transmit time, so the time from the array to the scatterer, and the receive time from the scatterer back to the array. And this time is then used to assign this value to a certain depth. So this depth corresponds to the speed of sound and the total round trip time. So this value is then assigned to the pixel where the focus is located. And then by scanning the confocal beams over the imaging plane, one receives like a response of an echo. And diameter is determined by the confocal diameter of the two beams. And the length is determined by the impulse response of the transducer. So this gives the temporal profile of this impulse response, gives the axial profile of the echo. And in conventional ultrasound imaging, the scanning is done in a collinear way. So the transmitting beam and the receiving beam are along one line and the tissue is scanned. And the focus of the received beam is adapted to each depth separately. So you can focus in each depth, whereas typically the transmitting beam is only focused at one depth or two or three different depths. And this then generates the radio frequency mode image. So this is derived from the radio frequency signal. And in such an image, you can look at the small area here and you see like the bicolor pattern of this image due to the impulse response of the transducer. But conventionally, we don't delay the images, display the images like that, but what we use is the intensity of the echoes, so the squared enveloped amplitude of the radio frequency mode image. And this is then logarithmically compressed, so we show this intensity in a decibel scale. And that's how then a typical image looks like, where you can see the liver, you can see a fat layer, you can see muscle layer, and here also fat layer. So this is how it is done in conventional echo ultrasound. But now in Qt, we make more use of the liberty that we have with these linear array transducers. So what we do is we use collimated beams and we explicitly steer these beams at a certain selection of transmit and receive angles. And the idea is now that when we have like these two beams crossing at the point and we have a reflector in that point, and we have some area inside the tissue which has a different speed of sound than the background, or than the assumed speed of sound, what will happen is that the reconstructed position of the echo will differ from the actual position of our reflector. And this offset here is directly linked to the error of the assumed speed of sound. So the total round trip time is different to what we would expect due to this speed of sound area here. Unfortunately, this offset cannot be directly measured because you don't know the true position of the echo. But what can be done is we use two pairs of transmit and receive steering angles. So not just one, but two. And what then happens is because the acoustic round trip path changes in between these two angle pairs, we will have a shift of the offset. So the offset will change of the echo. And this shift can be measured. So one way how this can be done is by using phase correlation technique and detect the phase shift of the echo. And in that way, at each echo position, one can quantify this phase shift. Then by scanning the crossing point of all these beams all over the imaging plane, what we get is a 2D map of echo phase shift. And so in this example, there has been something with a different speed of sound here in the imaging plane. And below that, we see the positive and negative phase shift due to the speed of sound non-uniformity. Now we can even get a step further and we can augment our data. So we don't just have to use one pair or two pairs of transmit receive angles, but you can use many different transmit and receive angles. In this example, we were using a transmit angles phi ranging from minus 25 degrees to 25 degrees and 10 degrees steps, and the receive angles also in the same range. And then you can make many different combinations of these angles. And what we do is we change, like starting from one angle, we change the transmit angle in one direction, positive direction. And simultaneously, for example, here, reduce the receive angle, so change it in the negative direction. And then for all of these combinations, one can produce a 2D map of echo phase shift, and you can see that there's a rich amount of data. So now the question is, how do we get to the speed of sound using this phase shift data? And this is, of course, a classical inverse problem. And what we make is a first a linear forward model of the relation between the speed of sound and the echo phase shift. And actually, we are looking not at the speed of sound directly, but at the sigma here, delta sigma. And this is the difference between the inverse actual speed of sound and the inverse of the assumed speed of sound. So the inverse speed of sound is also called slowness. So this is basically the difference between the actual slowness and the assumed slowness. And this is our object function. And then we say that any deviation, so any deviation of sigma from zero corresponds to an error in the speed of sound that we assume. And this generates an error of the round trip time. And this round trip time error we call tau. And we make a straight ray approximation of sound propagation and say that this round trip time error is a line integral along the propagation path of the ultrasound of this delta sigma. So we have actually a combination of two line integrals, one for the transmit path and one for the receive path. And then we have a model for the offset, so for the shift of the echo from the true location to the reconstructed location. And here, I don't want to go in detail. You can read that in this paper here from Patrick Staley. And this is basically the sum of the two aberration delays, the two timing errors divided by the cosine of the difference of the angles. And from that, so if you do that for two angle combinations, you then get an expression for the phase shift. The important thing here is that this is a completely linear forward model. So the phase shift is linear in, finally, if you put the integral C is linear in the delta sigma in our object function. And because of that, we can formulate the forward and the inverse problem using matrices. So what we do is we have all these 2D maps of echo phase shift, and we can discretize them typically in 50 by 50 pixels, and they put all these values inside a vector. On the other hand, we have the 2D reconstructed spatial distribution of the sigma, of the delta sigma, and we also put these values in the vector, and then we say that the delta theta is a matrix M multiplied with this delta sigma vector. And this matrix contains the line integration weights. Unfortunately, this problem is ill-posed, the inverse problem. So what we do is we make a pseudo-inverse in a very typical way, where we have like a regularization term here. And then we say the reconstructed delta sigma is this pseudo-inverse multiplied by the delta theta. And the important thing here is that this operation is real-time if we use a pre-calculated pseudo-inverse. And if we use like 50 by 50 pixels procedure for the speed of sound image. So this is quite fast. And by doing that, so departing from this echo phase shift data, we use this formula to calculate the delta sigma. And then again, taking our initial assumption, the speed of sound, the C0 that was used for the delay in sum, we can combine this information and then recalculate the speed of sound. And you can see here nicely that there was an area with higher speed of sound in the background at this location, which produced this echo phase shift data. So in clinical application, what is very important is quantitative imaging. So for example, for diagnosing fatty liver disease, we need to have an accurate value of speed of sound. And to demonstrate that this is possible, we did a phantom study with phantoms consisting of gelatin. We are using cellulose for acoustic scattering, and we use oil in gelatin emulsions to simulate fat. So we built different layers, and these stamps were inspired by actual application examples. So here's like liver and the big fat layer, and we have this two-layer phantom with a low speed of sound layer here and high speed of sound layer here. We have a more complicated location where we have muscles in between the fat layers and the liver. And this is an example showing a breast tumor, and this phantom is mimicking such a situation. And the speed of sound values that were chosen to give a realistic speed of sound contrast. The absolute values, they are not completely realistic, but that's not so important. So the important thing is to have a realistic contrast. And for the ultrasound acquisition, we use the Versonix Vantage 64 system with a 5 MHz center frequency array transducer. So these are the results. Here, what we see is a comparison of measured and simulated echo phase shift, just to show that our model is correct. So the points are the measurements, and the big line, the solid line is the prediction, and they agree very well. That's for a layered phantom, and this is for a cylindrical phantom. So we see a very good agreement. But also looking at the reconstructed speed of sound images, we see that they're really nice. So we have uniform speed of sound in this layer and in the liver layer. Here we have the highest speed of sound in the muscle layers, and we also see the cylindrical inclusion. And comparing the reconstructed speed of sound values in the different compartments, they agree very well with the reference values shown in gray. And they especially agree well for the liver layer. Here you see that the values lies on the reference line here, but also here for the cancer band, and here you see quite good agreement. So far I haven't yet said a lot about the regularization, but yes, because it's important, we need that. And in our very first approach, what we use is a regularization of the mean squared delta sigma. That's like the most naive approach, but it also works quite well. But the disadvantage that is that it biases the delta sigma towards zero, and therefore the speed of sound towards our a priori value. So this is difficult for quantitative imaging. We don't want to have that. So that's why we then turn to regularization of the mean square scale gradient of delta sigma. So we have like matrix operators for spatial derivative in X and in Z, and we have regularization parameters here, and this is our pseudo inverse. And the reason why we chose this regularization of the gradient is that it does not influence the average speed of sound. So we do not introduce a bias of the speed of sound using this technique. And this technique was used for this phantom study, and it worked very well, as we've seen already. And when we're looking at the values, we see that all the reconstructed values were located within a plus minus 10 meter per second band around the reference value. And this is about the accuracy that we want to get for liver imaging. However, if we use the same technique for actually in vivo measurements, we see a much worse performance. So we see that the speed of sound of the liver, so here's the liver speed of sound, you see the fat here, this is the muscle. Different examples, and you see that depending on the location of the body, and also just by replacing the transducer a little bit, you get a huge variation of speed of sound values. And this is significantly outside our desired speed of sound band. So the question is, what is the reason for that? And that's very simple. If we compare phase shift measurements that we get with the liver phantom, and if you look at phase shifts detected in an actual in vivo scenario, so this is, geometry is very very similar, speed of sound contrast is very similar, and you get very similar phase shift values, phase shift magnitudes. However, what you see here is a much stronger phase noise, so stronger fluctuations of the echo phase shift. And there are many potential reasons, but we won't detail on that now. But it's simply because tissue is more complicated than a phantom. And now the problem is, so we have this larger phase noise in vivo compared to phantoms. And of course, we could say we simply do a stronger regularization. But then the problem is that we also have these very sharp boundaries in between tissues. Where we know that the speed of sound changes very rapidly, and these boundaries are blurred out. And when the blur becomes too big, then it feeds back on the actual speed of sound values, and the whole thing becomes unstable. So this is the way of regularizing the spatial gradient is not very advantageous for getting good results. And also, this technique was always somewhat blind heuristic approach. So our goal was to find a new approach which is less blind. And so the goal is to motivate the regularization parameters by what we actually know about the physics of the tissue sample. So what we make is like an explicit statistical model of the reasonable speed of sound distributions that we could expect inside a tissue. And the second part of the goal was to include a priori knowledge of tissue interfaces, because we can get this knowledge from the D-mode echo ultrasound images. For the V-mode echo ultrasound images, and we know these interfaces, and we can use them for a better reconstruction of the speed of sound. So that's the goal. And the solution approach is to use a Bayesian approach for speed of sound reconstruction. And in this Bayesian approach, I think you are familiar with that. But it's so we have the Bayes theorem, where we say we have the product, the probability of having a certain speed of sound distribution given the measurement is the product of our a priori model of the speed of sound distribution multiplied with the probability distribution of getting the measurements given this speed of sound distribution. So we have a priori model of the distribution of the object function, and this is like a Gaussian model where we have a spatial covariance matrix of our object function. And on the other hand, we have the forward model with the noise, and we have a model, a statistical model of the noise, where we also say the noise is Gaussian distributed. So the parameters that we have in these models is on one hand the expectation value of the delta sigma, which we could in principle define per pixel, but we assume a value that is constant over the whole imaging plane. And then we have the spatial covariance matrix, and we have the noise variance. And now we want to include information on the boundaries between the tissues. So we have these conventional D-mode ultrasound images, where we can segment the boundaries between the fat, the muscle, the inner fat, and the liver tissue. And based on so far this manual segmentation, we get then this map of the different tissues. And then what we say is that if we have a pixel I inside a certain segment, so this is segment 3, and we have another pixel J inside the same segment, then these are correlated. And we say we have this correlation coefficient rho, which describes this correlation. The correlation of a pixel itself is simply the S squared of the sigma. And if we have two pixels which are not in the same tissue compartment, then the correlation is 0. So this is how we build the covariance matrix. And so we did that again, first in a phantom study, where we had different liver phantoms with different speed sound values inside the liver layer. And also we used two different noise levels. So on one hand, we have the noise level, which is from the actual measurement of the phantom. But then we also add a synthetic noise level, which matches an in vivo, a realistic in vivo case. And then we compare the two approaches, the gradient regularization and the Bayes model. And these are the regularization parameters that we used. They are not so important, but they were optimized. That's important. They were for each technique separately optimized to get the best agreement between the reconstructed and the known speed of sound of the phantoms. And if we now look on the right side for the results again for the boundaries of the different compartments, you see that with the spatial gradient technique, regularization technique, we get quite a bad distribution of the results with the high noise level, whereas it's quite good with the low noise level. So if the low noise is like the previous results, But now with a high noise level that's more realistic, we also get a quite large deviations in the phantom. However, with the Bayesian approach, you see a perfect agreement between the reconstructed values of speed of sound and the actual reference measurements. So in the next step, we tested this approach also again in vivo. And so these are four examples where here you see the remote ultrasound images, we see the segmentation of the different tissue layers. Below you see the reconstructed speed of sound distribution, and you see how nice they look like. So very uniform inside the different compartments. And also what you see is that the speed of sound inside the liver is quite stable across the different examples. Here are these speed of sound values of the liver summarized, and you see that they all lie within plus minus 10 meter per second band that we wanted to achieve. If we now compare that to the figure that we've seen earlier on, so these sound values measured by the Langevin Institute, you see that the accuracy of this technique is actually it's very good in comparison. So it promises that we are able to detect increased liver fat content quite early. Here, just for comparison, again, the results with the gradient regularization, where you see the strong improvement of the robustness of the speed of sound reconstruction. These are more in vivo results, and these are now from 3 different volunteers. And it's just to show that we are able to detect speed of sound differences in the liver between different volunteers, but they are more like they look the same if you do multiple measurements in the same volunteer. So that's the goal, that we are robust, but we are also very sensitive to variations between volunteers. However, so far, the segmentation was done in a manual way. And this, of course, inhibits completely real-time imaging, because it cannot, for each location of the transducer, you have to do a new segmentation, and you cannot do that in real time. So the solution approach is then, of course, to use deep learning-based automated segmentation, and also the whole processing chain has to be fast enough. And the problem is that with this Bayesian approach, because we include priors on the distribution of the tissues, you have to redo the model inversion for each location of the transducer. So this is very, very computationally intensive, and that's why we wanted to implement that on GPU. So for the deep learning, what we use is a typical UNet. And just my naive interpretation of this technique, and for the ones who are familiar with it, it's a convolutional network. And what it basically does, it does a transformation of the input, which in our case is the remote image, to a feature space. And the feature space is in a very low spatial resolution, but it can differentiate between different tissues. But once these features are like identified, or like the segmentation is somehow done, we want to recover the spatial resolution. And this is done by these two connections, which transfer like the original spatial resolution to our final image. So that's how we get the sharp boundaries between the different segments. And we basically took that unit from this publication here, the famous one, and slightly adapted it. So we have an input of 256 by 256 B-mode images. And on the other hand, we have our manual segmentations, which we use for training. And these are like 2D maps of the same resolution. And we have seven different labels. We have 6 labels for the different tissues, plus an additional labels for like fallouts. And so we trained this network using a training set of 61 manually segmented abdominal B-mode images. and they were acquired from one subject, one single volunteer, and with a clinical system, the supersonic imaging Mach 30. And so this is the basic training set. But what we then did is some data augmentation, and the training was a total 300 epochs, and for each epoch we used two images, but we also used like random transformations of these images. So we had like horizontal flip rotation, translation, field transformations, zooming, and brightness adjustments. So in total we have 600 segmented images. This is an example of the testing, and the nice thing here is, so while the training was done on one ultrasound system, we could then also employ it for our Verasonic system. And also, even though it was trained on only one volunteer, we could use it on different volunteers with nearly equally good results. So here's just one example, where you see the segmentation, the automated segmentation between fat, muscle, fat, liver, for one subject, different positions, other subject, different positions, and here for the different system. And note that the different coloring here is not due to segmentation errors, it's simply due to the choice of the color map, because these results are quite recent and preliminary and not yet well coordinated. So finally, using this unit, we implemented, or Patrick implemented, the whole processing chain on our Verasonic Vantage 128 system using MATLAB and NVIDIA ENY Quadro P 2200 graphical card. And the challenge here was to per second, so we achieved a frame rate of 1 per second, find the total frame rate of sound images. Second, we had to reconstruct the demo images for all angles, and this is actually a huge amount of angles. Then doing the face tracking, doing the automated segmentation using the neural network, and then also doing the pseudo inverse at each step. So all of that is done in 1 second. And so this is really a very preliminary result. It's just illustrate like the frame rate and the stability of the speed of sound reconstruction. So you can see it's the segmentation is really good. It quite or very accurately adapts to the actual tissue layers. The stability of the speed of sound is also quite good. You can see sometimes, for example, here in the fat layer, it varies a bit and reaches unrealistic values, but the liver speed of sound is in a quite good tolerance span also. So in conclusion, we demonstrated that we can do quantitative pulse echo mode speed of sound imaging in phantoms. What I forgot to show is that the speed of sound values that we get in the liver actually agree very well with what is expected for healthy liver. And we have shown that the Bayesian approach greatly stabilizes the reconstructed liver speed of sound in vivo results. And preliminary, we have like one frames per second real-time frame rate of the Bayesian approach. So these are again the publications from Patrick on the forward model and on the Bayesian approach. In case you are interested, you can make a photograph. And so the next steps are that we want to do a patient study of liver steatosis. This is together with supersonic imaging. Now Hologic was purchased by Hologic. So we want to use this system for doing a patient study on liver steatosis. And for that, we have to translate the system to a curved sector array. And the other thing is to optimize the automated segmentation, so it's not perfect yet. And of course, for that, we want to train on a larger group of different subjects and see whether we can improve the results. So thanks for your attention. I'm ready for questions now.